I think it's fair to say that going by the comment sections, I'm to incur some sort of judicial onslaught if I don't increase the length of my videos renovating Alan. Now, let's see if we can do a deal, that I increase the edit lengths, but not into dirgy, repetitive, half-hour behemoths. In return, we can agree to reclaim the comment section for discussions, questions, and all manner of other excitement. It doesn't escape me that it's something of a compliment that you generally want more and not less, so for that, thank you. I could elongate them by 10 minutes each by looping this endlessly.
Alan! Al! Alan! 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 Al! Alan! Alan! Alan!
But I won't push my luck. Right, let's get on with it. Today's episode is a collection of smaller jobs that don't deserve a whole episode each, but should definitely be shared. Let's start with Alan's bilges. The entire inside of the lifeboat was finished in fiberglass, both the hull itself and continuous moulded internal parts all filled with buoyancy foam. Unsurprisingly, the surface is therefore a gel coat, which is a usually pigmented layer of resin. It adds a fraction of a millimetre of glass fibre free coating, rather like a paint, but it's applied at the time that the glass fibre is laminated. It's the most popular way that fibreglass parts are presented, durable, waterproof, and either smooth or textured for different uses. The gel coat finish down below in Allen was dingy, grimy, and so I decided it needed some attention. My process was fairly simple, and as I've said a number of times, Allen's not a pleasure boat, so function trumps form, especially in the working innards. This is pretty much how I prep and get all non-cosmetic work done with single-pack paints or coatings. First, I degrease with brushes and rags to get rid of serious oil spills, fuel residue, and grime. I then wipe it down with blue rag to see if I've got it clean or need another go. Once free of the worst, I give it a good clean with sugar soap and then dry it with a microfiber cloth. Unless the surface is really waxy or shiny and so needs sanding to provide a key, I then crack on with the paint. The area around the engine is a pain for access, and wiggling brushes, rags, and fingers around pipes and metalwork is the order of the day. I've cleaned off flakes of old red paint from the engine and recoated in a fair few areas, but the focus on this occasion was on the four engine mounts. They appear to be fairly robust but rudimentary steel feet with a shock-absorbing pad, and were the only parts with paint really making way for rust. I'm certain none of the corrosion is deep or structural, but to keep the engine on the floor and not on the roof, I did a proper repair. I wasn't sure of all the materials, so used the Zinsser primer, which is a real lifesaver, and then plonked on the white, oil-based bilge paint and then tied it up with red metal paint. As I said, under the engine is a problem to get to, and even with extension rods and reaching in, it was a best effort job rather than perfection. I also took the chance to prime and repaint some rusting sections of the engine's giant flywheel. You have spotted the brand new, shiny alternator I put on last year, but electrics are for another time. To get into the build section below the propeller shaft casing required deployment of ingenuity, skill, and brilliance. I taped a paintbrush to a piece of scrap wood, and so managed to get into the final areas for a coat of white brightness. Whilst not quite complete, I was pretty happy with this, and immediately I've been able to make sense of more that's going on in the busy engine bay. I've also taken the opportunity to extend the spring cleaning and house proudness to the larger drop section in front of the engine. Originally in the lifeboat layout, this was an area for the small battery box that contained a couple of 12-volt engine crank batteries. Below that enclosure was a diaphragm to ensure that the lifeboat couldn't be released from the davits while still aloft in the air, and a pump to send seawater to the sprinkler system around Allen's exterior. I ripped all that out, obviously, as we have no need for the frivolity of a shower on the deck. There was a large resulting hole that I've closed up. This was a basic sandwich of steel plate, gasket rubber, nuts and bolts, and a liberal seal with those bolts of 3M5200. I blocked the other aperture with sealant and then locked it off with a female threaded cap. There is a battery box for four much larger lead carbon batteries, and these will be secured on top of the six black supports. This is so any bilge water can't reach the battery box, and also leaves space for installing high density ballast later. That's more or less all the painting work I'm going to do in the bilge and the engine area at the moment. And it might seem slightly strange that I'm doing something that looks a little bit cosmetic this early on. But actually it just means that you can see if there are any leaks. It's much, much easier to work when you actually have light reflecting around the engine bay. So I thought that actually doing this quite early on is a reasonably prudent thing to do. I consider it my duty to involve an angle grinder in any, and indeed all, tasks aboard Allen. there's nothing that the delicate touch of a grinding disc can't improve. I'm just getting the internal section of an obsolete piece of deck gear out the way here, ready for sorting out the bow section. The bilge used to run all the way from the propeller shaft area to this bilge at the bow. This continuation has been blocked off and foam filled below the racking in the middle section, so this is all that remains. I've earmarked the awkwardly shaped space for storage of the anchor, chain, and various other pieces of kit, so it gets the same bilge whitening treatment. The remaining large galvanized mass has been brushed down, cleaned, primed, and now can be painted as per the rest. My painting is usually as graceful as a politician dodging a simple question, but do forgive me, YouTube experts. Frankly, I was trying to do it while staring at a camera screen. Rather neat, I hope you'll agree, and I've put in the support rather like under the battery box so an anchor and chain storage bucket can sit inches above the bilge itself, which would of course collect water. I'm going to tag on a couple of extra smaller jobs to the end of the video. A lot of you ask for time lapses, and so here are some time lapses. You can have me prattling on instead of royalty-free music, and because the intro and outro guitar bit was actually quite expensive to license. I've mounted a mirror on each wall of what will be the living quarters. The reasons? To make it appear larger, to bounce more light, and because mirrors can be useful to check for medical issues and for monitoring the inevitable degradation of crew handsomeness. They are extremely thin sheets of stainless steel mounted on treated OSB board, so are shatterproof. The edges are messy, so I've set myself upon them with some basic top coat and low adhesion painter's tape. I'm still holding back safety fittings for later, but just to stem the tide of outrage in the comments, I have added some silicone corner protectors in the interim. And now another small job. Alan needs ventilating, otherwise it's going to be a fairly repulsive pod filled with fumes, humidity, and assorted horribleness. There are four of these 24 volt blowers. There's one on the back of the seat there, which is going to be an extraction blower. And then there's one input one here, which is going to be for bringing cool air into the engine bay to try and reduce problems with exhaust and also with the heat buildup. There's also another blower here, which is going to be part of the cabin ventilation system. I am going to do this in a lot of detail in the future, but I'm just going to give you a very, very brief glimpse of installing the final one of these blowers, which is going to be installed above it in the opposite direction so that I can control airflow in both directions. Unfortunately, these aren't reversible fans, so if you apply a reverse polarity to them, you don't get the same power in reverse as you do in the forward motion because of the way that the blades have been designed. I reuse a lot of the stainless screws, bolts and so on that we salvaged from when we uninstalled all the lifeboat gear, and that's exactly what I did here. I find the fiberglass pretty high density, so the pilot holes are only 1 millimeter smaller than the screws I then use to mount the fans. It means they bite nicely, but will actually go in without straining or cracking the resin. There's tons more to come about how the ventilation works in a later video, so you can add all your questions to the "how much did Alan cost" ones in the comments. Finally, I need some advice. These lifeboat release diagrams are stuck with an ungodly substance onto the gel coat. They will not come off. I've tried scrapers, chisels, solvents, stronger solvents. I want it gone. Any ideas? Oh, and buy my books. That'll help stave off the evils of pop-up ads or Patreon. People also seem to like reading them. Goodbye.